So I think everybody is joining our webinar. I'm happy to have you all here. Hello, everybody. I'm seeing the first chatting box coming up. Hi, everybody. Thanks for being here with the Eans Neurotrauma section. Today's webinar will be about something we were eager to share with you, which is the experience of the committee members with the Neurotrauma Lab. So we will talk today about several aspects of translational research, which I'm very eager to know myself more about. I will share with you my screen just to know our lineup of speakers. So first of all, we will have Dr. Dietwurst and Professor Depetier about cerebrovascular physiology in large animals. So this is the first talk we will hear from, and then we have Professor Rostami about translational neurotrauma, then Dr. Alexander Yunsi about a step-to-step guide, which will be very useful as well, and then we will end with Professor Marklund on translational studies of wet matter injury in TBI. So if I think we're ready to start, so we're kind of the number of participants is rising, so I'm glad about it. But I think we're ready to start. Dr. Dietwurst is hey. Professor.
Yes, thank you, Laura, and thanks a lot for organizing this webinar, which will be very interesting. I was very much looking forward. So I will share my screen and pull up our presentation. I hope everything works for you.
Perfectly, yes.
Okay, thank you. So in Leuven, we have a porcine cranial window model, which we developed or actually modified from an existing model a couple of years ago. And as a first thing, if you want to do research on animals or on living tissues, the first question you have to ask is, do I need an animal? Can I not do it with a tissue culture, for instance? And if I need an animal, what sort of species do I need? And the smaller or the lower you go, the better. And there are principles behind that, the principles of the three R's, we call that refinement, replacement, and reduction. So if you can try, if you think you will be able to answer your question by a lower species, that's obviously what you should do. Now, that is not what we did, and that's what I would like to explain. So what we wanted is that is to investigate the response of pile vessels to external stimuli, like changing blood pressure in terms of changing diameter and in terms also of the flow velocity of the red blood cells. And Sophie will explain how we exactly do that. And there are a couple of cranial window models that can be used for that. And the one that was developed by Michael Daly in Tennessee, and whom we got to know through the through the Glasgow group who tried to model that. And actually Michael Daly also developed it himself to model autoregulation, seemed very interesting to us. So we took that model and modified it a little bit according to our needs. And what we actually wanted to do is to quickly, we thought we could do it quickly, validate PRX as an effective and accurate and reliable measure of the actual phenomenon of pressure autoregulation. And the goal of that was to quantify confounders of autoregulation in order to enable us to stratify better and do better clinical studies on that topic. So this is a large animal model, and a large animal model comes with challenges. And as I just said, if you choose your topic and your research question, you should actually start or to think about going as low as possible, which we didn't do. So we started from an existing piglet model. And another thing is that the pig is, you may like that or not, but it's closest to the human cardiorespiratory physiology in animal science. You could use monkeys as well, but and subhuman primates, but that's then overshooting. So the pig is actually very well suited to answer questions that are physiological and have been used throughout different models. So that's a large animal, of course, and that comes with challenges. One of the challenges, and that's true for all animal research, you need to have ethics board approval. There are specific ethics boards in all universities that deal with that, and the requirements they ask from you in terms of providing sufficient comfort and avoiding suffer for these animals are a bit higher if you, in larger animals than in smaller animal and lower species. So that's obviously a first thing. And there are reporting duties associated with that. So you should report the number of animals you did and what happened in those animals. And that's just to justify that kind of experimental setup. And that is, well, we have a societal responsibility. So that's totally rightful to do that. If you work with large animals, there's time investment. Each animal, each experiment is a full day. It's like operating on a patient, and actually you create a surgery room and an ICU in your lab. And so it's not just doing a couple of experiments, that doesn't work. It's one day per experiment. The piglet is like a small patient, like a child actually. So there's a need for sufficient surgical expertise and also anesthesia expertise to deal with all possible problems that can happen during an experiment. And it also comes with a cost. And you see, and I won't go into detail, but there's a cost for the animals, and also for transportation, for housing them in preparation of the experiment, usually a couple of days on beforehand, for all the drugs you need, for sterilizing your instruments, for renting the OR room, etc. And so the budget we have, or the cost we have, is approximately 800 euros per experiment. And that does not account for the personnel. It's just for all the equipment and the animal you need. As for the large equipment you need in those kind of experiments, we over the past years, the budget built up to, we spent like about 160,000 euros. So it's quite expensive experiments. So what we did, and I will give the word to Sophie afterwards, we established the model we were happy with. We produced a paper on the basic autoregulation physiology, and that was the best abstract last year at the EANS. So we're very happy with that. And Sophie's work is now on identifying the influence of PCO2 on the autoregulation curve. We worked also on ketamine influence on the autoregulation curve. And now Sophie's also adding a human-like severe TBI to that model, because as for now, it's a healthy model. Usually there's many people involved in that kind of research. That's also true in our lab, and the other speakers will also highlight that, I think, and I would very much like to thank my collaborators, and I will now switch to Sophie. Okay,
good afternoon. I will talk a little bit more in depth about our model. And as discussed, our main research goal is cerebral autoregulation, which we have already established quite a bit. And now we are looking further for confounding factors on cerebral autoregulation. And our main interest is traumatic brain injury. So as discussed, we use a pig model, and the major the largest advantage of this model is that a pig has a gyrencephalic brain, so it is quite comparable to the human brain. As you can see, the construction is quite comparable, only they have a very large first nerve compared to humans. So we use quite young pigs. They are 7 weeks old and they weigh about 10 kilograms, so they are quite easy to handle. The other advantage is that their cardiopulmonary physiology is similar to humans. Which makes it during the experiment, like the blood pressure and the heart frequency is actually quite similar to a human, and we can directly translate it. Of course, there are some pitfalls in animal research, and like pigs, they are actually quite prone to stress. So this is something you have to anticipate to in order to have a good experiment, to have a stable experiment. Also, when you're manipulating a pig, they quite easily develop bradycardia or an AV block, and they are more prone to infection than humans. So our setup is, because of these pigs are prone to stress, we pre-medicate them inside their cage where they are surrounded with other pigs, so they are comfortable. Then we place a vascular access in their ear and we intubate them. And then we start a sedation protocol, which is also quite similar to what we use here in the ICU. We only use intravenous anesthesia because we know that gas inhalation, etc., interferes with vasodilation. So we place the catheter in the ear, and then we place also an arterial line to measure the blood pressure. Therefore, we use a Schwann-Ganz catheter, and that is simply because it's easily available to us. We can use the pediatric Schwann-Ganz, which we have here. And then in our model, we would like to investigate the influence of blood pressure. So we do not want to use medication for that, but we place a balloon. So this is a picture of the right groin of these small pigs. You can see the highest is a femoral artery, which is about the size of the MCA in humans. So we place a balloon artery in the thoracic aorta. When we inflate it, we will increase the afterload and this pig will become hypertensive. This way we don't have to use medication to provoke this. Or the other way around, we place a balloon in the caval fin. And then if we increase it, if we inflate it, then the preload will decrease and this pig will become hypotensive. So that was for the vascular access. Then for the cranial access, we are mostly interested in flow. So we place a cranial window before the coronal suture. We put a glass overneath it and then we put a camera so we can make movies and we can measure diameters and measure the flow. And also, of course, we place an ICP PbO2 probe. These are the medic ones. And we place a laser Doppler flow also to estimate the flow. So this is the window. You can see it installed with a glass overneath it, and we can actually look at the cortical arteries, which is our goal. We can measure the diameter, and because we fluorescently label the red blood cells, we can also track them and we can estimate the velocity. So this is also the material that we use. We have a Philips monitor, which we also use in the ICU, and we log everything with the ICM Plus monitor. And these are actually some results of my previous colleague who used this model also. And he was able to differentiate whether the diameter or the red blood velocity contributes the most to cerebral autoregulation, and that the plateau that is always discussed between 50 and 150 is actually a bit less. It's a bit more narrow. So then we are adding now the next step. And it was quite difficult to develop a TBI model. And we found in the literature, actually, the only group in large animals, in large pigs, they use a Higge device. And this is a rotational impact that they, and this is the only model that we have found that can provoke actually an augmentation of ICP due to the rotation. And so this is actually why we have a custom made prototype now, which we are installing in our animal lab, which gives a very rapid acceleration in the sagittal plane of these pigs. But this is ongoing research, so we will discuss this in a later meeting. So thank you very much. And if there are questions, we were happy to answer them.
So thank you so much. This was so interesting. And I hope that all questions can be answered at the end. I would love if you can stay online with us, if you're not, we don't have any clinical duties or commitments. So, okay, if you're staying with us, then we will please answer to the end. So the question and answers box is open. So if any has an answer or question to provide, just right in there. We go on with Professor Ostami, who's next in line.
Hi.
Hello. Hi. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Sorry, I had some trouble with. Let's see if I can share my screen. So, do you see my screen? Excellent. So I thought I would give you just an overview of different types of experimental models that we have. And I know I talked to Niklas and he will cover some of the ones that we have, that we both have. So I will start with telling you about our research in TBI. We basically try to have a translational research and a holistic approach to TBI, where we have models from in vitro models where we investigate, use different types of stem cells to investigate how they respond to injury. And then we have animal models and then our clinical study and postmortem and different registry studies. So based on today's topic, I will cover the in vitro model and our animal models that we have in rodents. So for the in vitro model, we basically use stem cells from wild type mouse and transgenic mice, and we grow the embryonic stem cells, and we use in vitro injury model, which is a simple scratch model that was developed by Anna Erlandsson at Uppsala. And you basically scratch the cells that you have grown in a dish, and you can see how they respond to injury dependent on the genetic background, and also use it as different types of drug testing assays that you can have. And we use this setup also for iPSC cells from humans, from TBI patients that we know have specific genetic background, and we know how they respond to injury, and we try to understand that using this in vitro model, and also test different types of drug to see how the response of different types of cells are to this. And for the TBI models, we mainly have three different types of rodent models. The first one that I don't work so much myself is a BLAST TBI model. And the second one is a penetrating injury model that I will talk about, and then the rotational TBI model. So basically what the goal is to try to mimic different types of TBI and understand the underlying pathology. These are usually used for rats, but we also can adjust the rigs to use them for mice. So when it comes to the penetrating injury model, if you look at the first picture with the schematic presentation of the model, you have the animal, and then you have a piston which will like shoot like a bullet into something that has different types of pins that you can use. So you can decide if you want to have a very sharp and small injury cavity, or you want a more blunt type of injury. And you will get a very focal injury where you have a lesion and a large cavity, and you will have the systemic blood in the pathology. So it's a very specific type of injury you create. It's also gradable, so you can have you cannot maybe call it mild to severe, but you can adjust the cavity that you create the injury. And it's also a very nice model for different types of treatment. This is from one of the papers that they used injection of different types of drug in the area, in the cavity, and then they studied how the area around the cavity responded to injury. And there are several different drugs tested with this type of model. So if you're interested, you can look into that or ask me some question about it later. Then we have also this rotational TBI model, which mimics a more diffuse axonal injury. It's a closed head type of TBI. So the rat or the mice is fixed into this bar, and you have this bullet or a piston that hits the beam that the animal is fixed to. So the beam, there is no impact to the head of the rat. It just creates a rotational injury, acceleration, deceleration. And and it's also gradable. So you can have mild and you can have very severe. So you create, histologically, you can see that you have beta APP expression, in particularly in the areas of corpus callosum. What is nice about this model is that it's gradable, so you can adjust how we could say how hard you hit the rats. So you could have very mild injury that you can see with the expression of the beta APP and also biomarkers in the blood, you can have more severe. So we measure both in the blood and the CSF, and you can see that you have increase of CSF injury biomarkers up to 2 weeks. But when you look at if you grade it at the lower end, and you look at different types of behavior study, you see that they do have these type of graphs are, for example, for memory, anxiety, etc. So what we could see was that they had transient memory disturbances and anxiety, but it's very mild. And usually it's after 3 to 5 days, it's like gone. So it's really a good model for mild TBI. And also you could use for repetitive mild TBI. And then there is this BLAST TBI model that is available. And I don't know if you are familiar, but the Iraq-Afghanistan war really put this on the map, the BLAST injury. The soldiers were not really having visible injuries or injuries that was could be seen by normal imaging, but they had really symptoms. They were, the hypothesis were that it, or they knew that they were hit by this waves from blast, different types of explosions. So different types of blast injury TBI model was developed. And this one is basically that they put the rat, it's like fixed here. And then you have the detonation and you explode and the rat is hit by this wave. And then you study how the brain, you could also study the lungs, etc., but the focus here is the TBI, how it respond to this type of injury. And there've been extensive research done on this one. And what we basically have done is try to, for example, with using different types of mRNA expression or gene expression to see differences between these three types of injury. And what this graph mimics is that you have different types of functional gene groups that are activated in a different way, depending on what type of TBI you produce. Of course, in the clinical settings, you usually have a mix of these types of injury, but in the experimental models, you could have these clean-cut types of injury that you can study. And we can also study the type of lesion, the cavity, the electron microscopy could detect different types of edema, depending on what type of injury you were looking at. So it's very useful if you have specific question for this specific type of injury. For example, if you're interested in diffuse axonal injury, then the rotational TBI model is very useful. You could also, this is, for example, where we try to map the beta APP expression, the axonal injuries in the rotational TBI model and the penetrating injury model. This is the area close to the cavity, and this is the area at the corpus callosum that we could see, although it is a mild type of TBI, the axonal injury is extensive. And you can also map, for example, different inflammatory response in these type of injury. And these are pictures for complement factors, which is a part of the immune system. And what we could see that the distribution of the inflammatory response is different between penetrating and rotational TBI model. And it's just an example how you can use different types of model to assess different underlying pathology in TBI. So this was my last slide. And if you have any further question or more detailed question, please let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. It was very interesting. And I have a lot of questions for later. So even if all the others, for now, there is nothing in the question and answer spot, but we'll keep going. Dr. Yunsi, are you there? Yes.
Yes, gonna share my screen.
Yes.
Okay, should be visible. So, thank you for the invitation and for the really great lectures so far. I'll try to give a little bit my perspective on, as a rather younger neurotrauma researcher, how to actually start this kind of research and to start a lab, so to speak. So these are my thoughts. I'm curious what you will say and what we will discuss later on. So a little bit background information. Our lab in Heidelberg is focused on developing experimental treatments for spinal cord injury primarily, and also at TBI. And we started with in vivo experiments, as you will see later on, and we do a lot of in vitro work as well nowadays. We are quite young, so we established this in 2016, part of our department. And the team is growing. It was really small at the beginning, and now we have a lot of several students and also medical staff members from our department. I would say now a wide range of models and methods through a lot of collaborations, some funding, and we try to be active and publish and be present on conferences, what I think everybody tries to do. So I want to tell you a little bit the story how I started with this kind of research. So again, I'm a neurosurgeon, and in 2016, one of my former attendings, Professor Zegberger, friend and colleague, who's now chief of neurosurgery in Braunschweig, he came back from a stay abroad at Michael Feeling's lab in Toronto. Probably a lot of you are very familiar with his work, and he was motivated to do a project on his own. And I was a resident at the time, and I had a colleague, good friend, and we were very interested in doing this kind of lab work. We had some knowledge on our doctoral thesis, but beside that, no previous experience with neurotrauma research and models. And we had a lot of support by Professor Unneberg, the head of my department. I'm very thankful for who is a specialist in neurotrauma research himself. And he was, I think, happy to support this young group. And then we decided we want to do a project. We started with one project, and this is the project I'm going to talk about, and formed a lab with three members, basically. And I want to give you, in retrospect, a little bit the steps that it took us to start this work, this first project. And maybe this is helpful for some of the listeners who are interested to do a similar thing, or to start their own research project and lab potentially. So obviously the first question is, what do you want to research? What is the focus of, what is your interest? And either you have somebody who is a specialist already, he tells you what you could do. But in our case, so we went into a lot of reading. Obviously, that's what everybody should do. PubMed search on spinal cord injury. We wanted to do spinal cord injury. I was really interested in spinal cord injuries, in neurotrauma, and then neuroregeneration. So how to regenerate lost tissue and lost function. If you see those patients, I don't have to tell you, then you know that this is something really important, and there's a lot of treatments lacking. So a lot of hits in PubMed. You need to do some deep dives. You read more into one direction, the other direction. You look a lot at the cross references, and it became clear that we are most interested in stem cells, so less hits. And then due to obvious reasons for maybe people who work with those kind of cells, we come to the conclusion that we are interested in doing some research with neuronal precursor cells. We want to use NPCs for spinal cord injury treatment. So in this step, I think, looking back, it was really important to collect and manage all relevant publications. So you should probably start with a publication manager straight from the beginning. And what is really, I think, good is if you read so much, especially in the beginning phase, then you should use this all this knowledge in publications together to maybe, if you have a very specific research question later on, to use it for writing a review, actually. And then another thing I realized is this is science. So usually people are quite friendly and open. If you contact authors, because you know all the publications do not always speak the truth, and there's a lot of questions around what is published, you can contact people and they answer you, and they even send you stuff sometimes. So this is, I think, quite efficient. Another thing that I did, and that I think is very good, crucial as well, is to attend conferences and events and lectures and webinars like ours now. It's now easier than ever, obviously, with all the virtual stuff, to get ideas as well. And I want to do a little bit of publicity for our for the INTS biannual meeting that is going to take place this year in Berlin. And we from our department organizing it with Professor Plessina from Munich and Professor Zickberger from Braunschweig. So feel free to look at the conference website to ask questions. So this is supposed to be a very good conference for neurotrauma research. Another thing that I did myself as well, and I think that it was also very helpful, is to visit a lab that is already existing, or do an observership in a group that is very active. So I went to Toronto as well, to my feelings lab, just not so long, but just to get some insights. And I'd like to invite everybody who is interested in doing this here in Germany, in Heidelberg, to contact me. We'll talk about it later on as well, but this is always possible. Come and have a look at what we do and learn from people who did a little bit more than you did. So I did the same, and I think it was really helpful. And then there's a lot of discussion, obviously, with the peers within the department and also with other researchers on the campus. And at the end, for our first project, building of our lab, we came to the conclusion our research question should be, can we improve neurodegeneration after experimental spinal cord injury by transplanting NPCs? And next step was to actually make a plan and make a concept. And this is quite difficult. So looking back, I would say, start from the end and think about how you want to measure the effect of your treatment. So in our case, treatment should be NPCs, neural precursor cells. How would we like to measure it? And then you look at all the possible outcome measures. And for our experiment, we decided to use the BBB score as a primary functional outcome measurement. The catwalk gait analysis, another fairly objective outcome assessment tool for rodents, especially, and a gridwalk test. So you have this set of neurotests, and we have a primary outcome measure. And then we decided we want to assess the spinal cord injury and potential treatment effects with MRI as well. We want to do a retrograde fiber labeling. So we had to collect data on those outcome measures. And then the mainstay of our tissue analysis should be just immunohistochemistry, immune fluorescence. So with this set of outcome measures, you can take the next step, my opinion, and decide what kind of injury you want to do. This is from zero, right? You didn't do anything before, so you have to learn everything from scratch. So we looked at injury models. Obviously, we went to Michael Feedings in Toronto, and they used the clip compression contusion injury model a lot. And we decided we want to use the same. So this is the fairly commonly used clip compression contusion injury. You do a laminectomy. In our case, we wanted to do a cervical one because we thought if we do it cervically, because this is where most injuries happen and this is where treatment would be most beneficial. So basically you perform a cervical laminectomy. We chose the C6 level, not too high, not too low. And then you apply a clip with a constant clip force for 1 minute, the same surgeon all the time. And you can actually see the contusion compression injury here on the spinal cord. And this then defines the group design. So in our first project, we had a treatment group, the NPC group, and obviously a placebo group, a vehicle group, and a sham group. So this is how you could design your first experiment as well. Next step was to specify the treatment, in our case, the NPC transplantation. So you have to think about how you get the cells. In our case, we later on created the primary NPC cell line ourselves. And then you have to assess the tripotency of the cells. You have to look at the viability. So this is all stuff that you have to read and put into your plan before you even start. And you have to think about how you want to transplant the cells. We chose an injection, stereotactic injection with a Hamilton syringe, as you can see here. And then the cell graft is actually really transplanted. So this happened all later on, obviously. And then very important part, calculate the necessary group size. We also take into account rates of mortality and error. Mortality in those models can be quite high, especially in rodents and cervical spinal cord injury. And then next step for me is always to create a timeline. The timeline for our first project looked like this. You also have to define how long you want to assess the treatment effects. So in our case, 56 days. And if you have all this ready, and you should collect all the information together while conceptualizing and planning your experiment all the time, note the producer, the supplier, the quantity, dose, concentration, price, because it will really help you later on if you go shopping for this. And then at the end, you combine everything into a written project proposal, and you outline in detail what you want to do, because now you've made up your plan. And this is typically also the basis for animal ethic applications, grant applications, etc. So you, if you have done this, it's all the theoretical work. I think you're ready to move to the next step, which is, the previous speakers have talked about this, have touched this, which is, I think, acquire funding, because this kind of research also with rodents can get quite expensive. And in my opinion, what you should do, you should screen local sources first, because it's sometimes really surprising how many, you know, also smaller grants, local grants are available. We found an innovation fund from the local interdisciplinary neurobehavior core facility of our university. And we got, we got a grant of 5,000 euros from them, and we applied for a little bit bigger grant on a, I would say, international level from the Cervical Spine Research Society. And that's something, if you apply for funding for the first time, it's quite crucial. And if you haven't done it before, you should get some help. For our first grant proposal, we got a little bit of help from Toronto as well. And I know some people who also use professional agencies. So depending on what you aim for, this might be helpful. For our first project, we were able to get another 30,000 euros approximately. So this is the overall budget that we had. And this is obviously sufficient for this kind of project. My honest opinion is to apply for everything possible, also the smallest, you know, poster prizes. Try to get everything, because you will need this kind. You will need the money, and if you plan your experiment and you have a higher error rate, or if you have other problems and you need additional materials, consumables, and you run out of cash in the project, that's terrible. So you have to have this kind of backup. So apply for everything that you can get. And these are some examples that we, at least for our German audience, would maybe suggest. So the Spinal and the Neurosurgical Societies, the German Science Foundation, of course, and then some European and also international agencies. And there's the Hannelore Kohl Stiftung in Germany, open for funding for TBI research especially as well. Then next step for us, because we started from scratch, is to find partners. Why? Because if you do this kind of new trauma experiment for the first time on your own, you run into a lot of problems. Many of the methods, techniques, first of all, require costly equipment, and you just can't afford it with the money you just acquired. It's impossible. Then if you don't have a lab space, which we didn't, which if you start, you probably don't have as well, to just rent space for any kind of experiment is really difficult. There's just no space, or it's expensive. Then the more complex methods, in vivo and in vitro, they have a lot of, you have to have experience, they have a long learning curve. And if you have somebody who can properly guide you and explain to you, that helps a lot. And what you have to realize is that even with the best plan, best planning, there will be, for the first experiment especially, countless challenges. And if you have somebody you can talk to who's a little bit more experienced, not necessarily in the neurotrauma field, but in general research, then this is really helpful. So don't do it on your own. If you are in a situation like we were, Heidelberg University is a huge campus. There are a lot of facilities, a lot of labs and institutions. I'm sure that if you're nice and polite, you will find somebody who will do research with you. Those researchers could potentially provide intellectual input during the planning phase already. could continuously discuss everything you do with you. In our case, this was important. You can get cost-free or cost-reduced materials, equipment, lab space. In Heidelberg, we have core facilities that really offer this kind of service to young researchers or to researchers who don't have the means yet. You can get practical support for, you know, learning the methods, for example. And you can also get better access to additional grants funding. And if you have one collaborator, it's easier to get another one. So you can essentially form a network for yourself, and this helps for future experiments a lot. So just briefly, in our case, I also want to thank Professor Scutella, who was our first collaborator, partner, and became a very, very solid and constant research partner for our team and lab from the Department of Anatomy and Neuroanatomy from Heidelberg University. So he and his team helped us a lot with the neuronal precursor cell generation and in vitro work. And then we were very lucky to have Dr. Claudia Pizza on board. She is the head of the local behavioral assessment facility, and we were able to rent space there and get a lot of help with the neurotests. And also we got some space where we could do the first surgeries as well, and where the animals essentially lived and had their cages. And then in later experiments, just briefly, you meet new people, and we have some other collaborators that I just want to name and thank, because they in also other experiments helped us a lot and still do. So important. Next step, form a bigger team or form a team. So we started with two residents. We were very, very lucky to get two doctoral students. And this kind of project, spinal cord injury, cervical, 50 animals, 8 weeks approximately, it's a lot of work. And not only the preparation, but actually really doing the experiment. And you need more hands, or you have to be a crazy worker. Also, you have to have time, obviously. So this is another aspect. You cannot do it only at night and on the weekend. So we were very lucky to have those two doctoral students. And this, I think, is maybe even the most important step, to find people that you can motivate, that are motivated themselves, that grow with you. And those guys, for example, although we started from zero, they were trusting us and investing in our little group. And with them, we pulled off the first experiment. And then with every new experiment and project, obviously the team grows and is growing. And I'm really thankful to all of those residents and doctoral students and interns and PhDs to be there to help and to do this kind of work together. And as you probably can imagine, I mean, it's typically young, motivated groups, so there's a lot of social interaction as well. And if people are, obviously, if they are happy and work happily together, then this is very fruitful for this kind of research as well. Next step. So this is just for your information, who is doing what in our group, but not so important. You have to establish the models and methods. And before you actually start the first experiment, you have to be able to perform the methods and to master the model appropriately. Otherwise, you have a lot of bias when you do, for example, the surgeries and even other smaller things like animal handling and care. So that's all the stuff you have to train or get trained in. So how to handle the animals, how to perform the basic basis of your research, the clip compression contusion, SCI in our case, small stuff like how to manually squeeze a rat bladder, because they can pee after the cervical SCI, how to do injections, then how to transplant the cells, and so on. So there's a lot of things to learn. This is usually done at night and on the weekends. If you reach a certain plateau, then you're ready to actually start the experiment. You also have to be able to do the preparation stuff, in our case, to generate the NPCs, to culture them, to properly assess them. And then you also have to train a little bit the neurotests, and you have to get accustomed with the tissue analysis. So when the experiment is over, the rat is sacrificed, it goes on, right? So you have to perfuse the animal, you have to prepare the tissue properly. In our case, you have to do cryosectioning, you have to do the antibody stainings. depending on what you want to do. And then it doesn't stop there. You also have to do imaging analysis. You have to learn how to use a laser scanning microscope, maybe some imaging software, and then statistical analysis as well. So this is all still part of the fairly practical preparation. And then, you start to work. And in our case, so this, again, the first project, very intense. So you do, as you can see here, you do nice things together as well. And there's a lot of documentation. And the rats, when you do it the first time, you sometimes also feel sad because they're injured. And so it's an intense, and I would recommend it to everybody. It's still a really a nice experience to do this kind of work, and you feel like you're really doing something. And then essentially, if you've done it, you can hopefully publish it. And obviously that's the goal that everybody has. So this is the publication for our first project, just as an example. And so this is one project, one experiment, but so the thing is that from there on, you have to continue. And what I can recommend is that if you, just before you finish the first experiment and you have nice results and you're happy and you're motivated, plan the next one already, create the next team already, and use this overlap time to teach the new team members with the ongoing project. And by doing this during the last years, we were able to do one experiment after the other. Just some examples, we worked with MPC-derived exosomes. Currently, we work with viral vectors that we try to use for cellular reprogramming in vitro and in vivo. So, skip the cells. That's a little bit the goal. We try to use treadmill training to enhance NPC transplantation. We tried growth factors to enhance NPC transplantation. We tried stabilizers of the BSCB, so just drugs, immune modulators. And I think that's what you would do then as well. If you do one project, it really gets the stone rolling, and you can continue, and then you can call it a lab later on, and it also feels like a lab and sometimes like a family. Okay, so that's it from my side. Kind of emotional talk as well. Thank you for your attention, and looking forward to your questions.
Thanks, Dr. Yurensi. Amazing. So off to Professor Marplund. So we have lots of questions already, so we'll keep going, and in the end we will do all the questions all together. Thanks for bearing with us.
So let's see, do you see my presentation? So you see one screen?
No.
I suppose, okay, so one
second.
So I should try to move this one. Okay, let's see. Come on. Can I stop this one? Try again. Let's see. Share. I don't know why it's not working. Sorry. Come on. It typically works every time. Let's see then. Okay, excuse me.
Perhaps close the PowerPoint altogether, yes, for a second.
Yeah, exactly. I'll do that. And I will open it again. Anyway, first of all, I'm grateful for the ENS, of course, and for Laura Lippe for making this happening. And I'm also very happy that so many are still here. So, and I really hope that this can work. Now, I hope.
Yes, it's perfect.
Okay. Yes, perfect.
Sorry about that. All right, I will share with you some of my thoughts on the translational studies of white matter injury in TBI. It's sort of a passion and a huge interest of mine. I do think the white matter injuries are key in TBI. And I will share some experience that I have that's quite similar to what Alexander Jonsi just showed you. But as you know, everything we do in research starts with a problem. And of course, it's TBI. It's named the most complex disease known to man in the most complex organ in the body, as you know. And those of you who are a clinician and work with this, you know that TBI is not one disease. Very many different disorders that can be complex due to any other comorbidities and age and gender and everything like that. And I'm particularly concerned about what you see, about the white matter. First of all, TBI is not one event. It's an ongoing disorder. And we know that TBI will accelerate brain aging, and you actually lose brain volume to the extent of Alzheimer's disease patient if you have a severe TBI. And this is particularly pronounced in the white matter. Of course, if you have white matter injury or axonal injury, you get network dysfunction. So many of the symptoms that patient will experience or the problems the patients have after TBI is related to axonal and white matter problems and impairment of the function. Furthermore, the white matter injury in TBI seems to be a crucial link to neurodegeneration. You probably know that TBI is a well-established risk factor for dementias, Parkinson's disease, and others. We can call it neurodegeneration, or we can call it TBI-induced encephalopathy. This is more of sort of the more severe TBIs. I also have a huge interest in sports-related concussions. This is a mild traumatic injury. You get it by rapid head rotation. And the key with this clinical problem is many of these get repeated injuries. And one of the many problems there's associated with this is that the outcome is worse in women. I'll come back to that later, but some of these athletes will develop persistent symptoms. Some develop neurodegeneration at a relatively young age, and some may even get this chronic traumatic encephalopathy, the CTE, that's characterized by aggregation of phosphorylated tau. And just briefly, we have a cohort of young, rather healthy athletes. They have persistent symptoms after typically several concussions, and we use 7 Tesla MRI to them. This is briefly showing that everything you see in bright color here is white matter abnormalities using DTI and particularly DKI, for those of you who know your MRI. I will come back to this. Well, what is this really? In another cohort that I've been following, persistent symptoms, we actually see, here's the top row here, so you see some orange dots here, this pathological aggregation of tau in 25-year-old athletes. They also have some neuroinflammation. And if we can compare that to TBI, young TBI patients also have more substantial tau aggregation and they have more neuroinflammation at the chronic phase, more than 6 months post-injury. So I use some method to study clinical TBI. Don't worry, I will get back to the experimental side. We do a lot of neurocritical care studies. We have advanced neuromonitoring, neuroimaging, everything like that. A lot of biomarker studies. And we do quite extensive follow-up on these. And what I think is also very important that we discuss experimental TBI is have something to compare with. And so I established a tissue bank for humans, like a fresh surgically resected human brain tissue from these severe and terrible TBIs that we had to remove surgically. So we actually the first to do some proteomics on fresh human tissue and TBI, and also on the epigenetic studies when we use this tissue bank. Sports concussion is a totally different story. It's much less severe injuries. I have a follow cohorts of young, but symptomatic athletes, persistent symptoms for more than 6 months. We do a bunch of things with them, detailed neuropsychology, tau PET, 7 Tesla MRI, balance testing, etc. And we also do fluid biomarkers on them. Combined, I create a hypothesis like this. I do think that TBI and or the sports-related concussion, they are a risk factor for neurodegeneration. And why is that? Well, I think you get axonal and white matter injury you get oligodendrocyte problems, you get demyelination, etc. Together, you will also get vascular dysfunction, you get tau aggregation, and you have this oligodendrocyte problems. And then the inflammation will also be involved in this. But this very detailed hypothesis, I cannot test that. I cannot do that in humans. So then you obviously need the animals, the rodent models of TBI. And I did my PhD thesis on experimental TBI. I went to the US to do a 2-year postdoc on experimental TBI. So I spent maybe too much time in my life on animal models of TBI. And there's some good chapters in this book as well, if you're interested in this. I'll mention a few of them. Because this slide again, the most complex disease is more than one disease. And then obviously to mimic these different types of TBI, you do need more than one TBI model as well, obviously. I need to mention when we talk about rodents and humans, obviously there are huge differences in brain size, anatomy, lysencephalic rodent versus charyencephalic humans. So there's a number of issues that you need to consider before you say this is clinically relevant. It's actually when we talk about rodents, they have less white matter content relative to the size of the brain than humans have, for instance. But still, there are similarities in how vulnerable they are, and also some key events happen also both in human TBI as it does in the rodents. And there are many studies, just one example. We know that humans get post-traumatic epilepsy, particularly if it's severe, particularly if it's penetrating. And yes, rodents, using the rodent models, they also get post-traumatic epilepsy. Brilliant work by Asla Pitkin in Finland. So there are many, I can do this forever, saying that there are relevant changes in the rodent that will mimic the human conditions. So back to the axon, it's a lot about its connectivity to other regions, but also the transport of proteins and factors back and forth in the axon. If it's injured, we get APP accumulation, and this classical axonal retraction bulbs, you get this, you can call in varicosities, disrupted axonal transport. You see this in human TBI, and you see it in rodent TBI. So we need ways of mimicking this disorder also in the experimental setting. And Bartlett Pretier showed how they do it in the pig, and Ellum shows how they do it with the rotational models. Many use this one, the impact acceleration model. It's called the Marmaru model. One limitation of this, you cannot use this in the mouse. It's typically used in the rats only. So I've chosen other models, and these are my favorite ones. This is the CCI, the controlled cortical impact, and the fluid percussion injury. As briefly mentioned, the CCI, it's super easy. You need to be able to drill a hole using the microscope, and then you attach a pneumatically driven piston, and you get a rapid impact to the brain of the rodent. It's very, very common. I would say it's the most widely distributed rodent model of TBI. But maybe this injury is a little too big, huge injury like this. So maybe it's less clinically relevant. It has many positive things as well. But I've chosen to focus more on other models. But I'm saying with CCI, it is more than a focal model. This is not like stroke. It's basically showing this is staining for neurodegeneration, ipsilateral, but over time, after 7 days, it will spread towards the other side. So you do get contralateral changes, and you do get diffuse changes as well. But what I like more is the fluid percussion injury. It's a 22 millisecond injury pulse like this. You get brain deformation, and it mimics many things that you may observe in human TBI as well. You can do it, you can place the craniotomy laterally, and you get more of a contusion-like injury or mixed model, some axonal injury, some contusions, or you can place it in the midline like this and get more of a pure axonal injury model. That's a central or midline fluid percussion injury. I went myself to the US to the lab of Professor John Pavlichuk, the editor of Journal Neurotrauma for many years, to learn to do this. I brought it back home to Sweden. you see up here, you need to drill a hole over the sagittal sinus in the mouse. Obviously, you can understand this is rather tricky surgery. Then you put the cement around it and put this sort of hub of a needle over this craniotomy. You fill it with fluid, typically saline, that you attach to this device. By letting this pendulum swing, you will get an injury pulse transmitted through the fluid in the cylinder, and that's transmitted then into the brain of the rodent. That's a midline fluid percussion injury. It gives apnea, it gives seizures, you get a lot of behavioral deficits, and you can grade it. And what's good, it can be used both rats and mice. On the downside, it's a difficult surgery. You get some bleeding, you get some mortality from the injury itself. And also, this is not clinically relevant in the sense that you do not get this long-term coma that diffusics only injury patient may have. But histologically, it's very good. We did studies of very complex behavioral change. We put them in this like box with different paths a rodent can choose. So typically, they would avoid an open space and, you know, how risk-taking are they, et cetera, et cetera. We can do detailed behavioral analysis. And if you do a neurotrauma lab, think very thoroughly what types of behavioral analysis you would use. You need something for cognition. You need something for motor function, balance function, et cetera. And you need something for more complex behaviors. I also spent too much time of my life writing this review together with my previous PhD student, but it's lot of different models enlisted in this paper. So we used these models, the fluid percussion models, to look for white matter injuries. So there's other components to it. It's not only the axon. Obviously, there's myelin produced by the oligodendrocytes. And strangely, that was kind of forgotten in experimental TBI research, not so much out there, but we started looking into it and we had this, if I can say it myself, pretty good thesis coming out and studying this. Oligodendrocytes, of course, they're interesting. And they keep myelinating and developing the CNS until we're around 30 years old. And each oligodendrocyte may myelinate more than 50 axons each. And they do have some other beneficial things in the brain. So I think they're important. And I want to look at this translationally, which I think is a way forward in TBI. We have clinical studies, we do experimental research. So yes, very briefly, we saw that oligodendrocytes die after TBI in the rat, like this, fluid percussion models. We can see that we provide an anti-inflammatory treatment, interleukin-1 beta, neutralization antibody. We will reduce the loss of mature oligodendrocytes. So that means we can rescue these dying oligodendrocytes. We can also show in those rodent models that we see proliferation of the oligodendrocyte precursor cells. Maybe they can replace the dying mature oligodendrocytes. In a way, a brain repair thing that's happening. But of course, this is rodent, this is rats and mice. Is this relevant to humans? Well, back to my brain bank tissue again. Very injured tissue in many ways, difficult to work with. But just using that, we see, yes, also in human TBI, oligodendrocytes, they die during the first week post-injury. And we can also see that we have increased number of oligodendrocyte progenitors. Going back and forth between the clinics and an experimental setting. And we can elaborate on this rather complex hypothesis. Many factors are involved here, of course. You have the TBI, you have microglia. We may influence this by treatment, interleukin neutralized antibody, for instance. And how this involved with the axon and the inflammation, the oligodendrocytes, and the path to neurodegeneration. I think this is probably one of the key aspects of the TBI pathophysiology that we can address and we can target that pharmacologically. Go back to the problem again. We saw this 7 Tesla DKI, a lot of changes. Everything in yellow here is significantly altered white matter tracks throughout the brain of otherwise healthy individuals. What are the DKI changes really mean? speculated, maybe astroglial changes. It can be what they call axonal varicosities. We don't know, this is humans. So we go back to the lab. We do this white matter injury model, central fluid injury. We look transsynaptically, and you see here very beautifully these axonal varicosities, disrupted transport in the axons like this. They're done on tissue cleared brains from a mouse TBI. So maybe we can start understanding what we see in humans by using experimental models. Of course, we have the small animal 9.4 test animal MRI. We've done a lot of things already. We haven't done DKI, but now when we have these findings in the humans, we will go back to the lab and do it in the mouse and really go into detail what it really means. So I guess that's a way to work with the translational aspects. So basically our approach to experimental TBI, this is not an event, it's an ongoing disorder. So we have animals that we have followed up to 1.5 years post-injury, which is a very long time in the rodent. We do injuries to the very young, to the aging and really old. We've done injuries to those who's almost 2 years old. Look for male-female differences, detailed behavioral analysis, of course. And we use this to evaluate pharmacological treatments. Can look for MRI, get beautiful tractography images like this, how the axonal pathology is evolving over time. We are working in vitro these days as well. And one focus is axonal injury mechanisms. And not least, as I mentioned briefly, the CTE, tau pathology. This is 2 up to 30 days post-injury. We see phosphorylated tau increases. And it's been speculated that TBI is a prion-like disorder. When once you start getting phosphorylated tau, it will just continue to evolve and grow and become more and more aggregated over time. So just briefly, how to do experimental TBI research. I will connect to what Alexander was just briefly referring to. Personal view, yes, you need to learn the models, of course, all this assessment. And I would argue do it early in your career. Later as a neurosurgeon, you will simply not have the time to do it. And go to see other labs. I've done it myself many times. And get your ideas in the clinical setting. Get to, see what's happening in the clinic, go back to the bench and, back and forwards. That's really translational work. And really refine animal models. Those are not clinicians. I get the feeling that they don't think in the clinical way. You should have a clinical eye when designing your studies to make them as clinically relevant as possible. And as mentioned, you need co-workers devoted to different aspects. And you need collaboration using your social skills. I have collaborations with experts in mitochondrial analysis. I cannot do that myself, simply have no time for that. Particular imaging, special techniques, et cetera. And when it's possible, try to take the key findings from your lab to the humans and make translation the key aspect of your research. But there are obstacles as well. If you're a neurosurgeon scientist, want to do this, the older I get, the more I think this is a problem. Administration. It's a killer, honestly. It takes so much time and it seems to be getting worse. But if you find a way around that, you need funding. Many agencies are really interested in translational research, but when it comes to practical sort of details, maybe I'm not that experimental that should be awarded, or maybe I'm not that clinical since I try to do both. So I have the feeling we don't get as much research funds as we deserve, perhaps. Then obviously as a surgeon, time is a limiting factor sometimes, but it's often worth it because it keeps your curiosity going and you can do a lot of interesting studies that help the patients in the future. So before I end, we are evolving and starting this organization, European Neurotrauma Organization, will be formally be launched at the INTS meeting in Berlin this summer. We are also launching the website very soon, so please note it, europeanneurotrauma.org. It's not up and running yet, but I hope we'll be up in a couple of weeks or so. And huge thanks to all my clinical and experimental collaborators and some a lot of thanks for my funding agencies as well. So thanks, and I'm happy to take any questions you may have. So thanks. I will stop my sharing.
So I can't be thankful enough for this webinar. I am elated to have so many participants sticking with us up until the end. We have a few questions, but the point is that in this webinar, the speakers were the chair, co-chair, former chair, and a neurotrauma lab director, and a PhD student in neurotrauma. So you have the very best of possibilities to get all your questions answered. And I think we are very lucky to have you all here for, it was very instructional actually for myself in first. So one of the questions that came up from a couple of people is that it's regarding how does a medical student, or when is the right time for a medical student or young neurosurgeon or young resident or later resident to start with lab collaboration, and how to reach out. So this is a question I want all of you with experience to answer. So I say, I saw that Dr. Yunzi already answered that to one question. Regarding the most appropriate time to join translational research.
I can just say, Marklund.
I know you can start. Go ahead.
I already wrote a long story. just my perspective. So it's probably never too late, but maybe sometimes a little bit too early. So if you're just a really fresh young resident and you just get accustomed with the clinical duties, can be intense. And I started, I think, quite late. In retrospect, would have been better to do it earlier. Now the younger residents, I encourage to, after the first 3 to 6 months, if they're really interested, to join the lab and join the meetings and the social activities and the journal clubs, and just be present and participate, and then help the older ones with their projects. And typically after around 6 months, maybe they are ready to, and they want to do their own project and get more practical. And I think you can basically restart early. So you just have to do it slowly. And you, in my opinion, you have to learn from the beginning how to handle both at the same time. Being, for example, a new surgeon, it's rare to get a long period of time off to just focus on the research, which is something you could aim to do as well. There are possibilities, but a lot of younger residents want to do both at the same time. And it's doable, but you have to slowly learn how to master it and not to, you know, overdo it maybe. So that's just my opinion.
I would argue to do it as soon as possible. If you're able to do it in medical school to get started, I think that's, of course, to recommend. I started my residency, and my supervisor said, you're going to do an experimental neurotrauma PhD. I had no experience whatsoever. So I tried to do it in parallel. It was doable, but I didn't sleep much for many years. And then I actually had 6 months of residency to actually establish the models. Wouldn't have been good otherwise. And still, you can do it. You're young and motivated. You can do it. But in the long run, you get tired. And the research will not benefit for you doing that all the time. So it takes some time off. I did it myself as a postdoc in the US, doing experimental TBI. So, and then no surgery. It was actually 2 good years, even though I missed surgery. So.
Thank you for answering. We are saying goodbye to Professor Rostami, who's on clinical duties and has another important meeting to attend. So. Thanks, Professor.
Yes, I'm so sorry. I can just add that I agree, and I think the timing is really depends on you. And as Niklas said, I also started very early. I actually started in my medical school, so it really depends on your goal. And so, if you don't know, just try it for a short period and see if it's something for you or not. but it really gives you a lot of insight and something, a perspective that only doing clinical work will not. But it's a fantastic journey. I would recommend everyone to try the preclinical studies and experimental models. It's really nice. I'm very sorry that I have to log out now, but it's thank you very much for having me here.
Thanks for being here. Bye. So there is another question for all of you, which is, can we visit your labs?
Can I take that, Laura?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I want to say, so adding to the previous, I think if you're interested in research, probably good, many universities offer research programs for medical students now to get a feel of it and to know, is that something for you or not, and to get some, to get acquainted with methodology. Now, answering this question, yes, people can, well, at least I'm speaking for myself now, can address me by email. It's probably easy to find people's emails in the papers, and that's certainly true. Now, what we would like to do with the trauma and critical care section in the near future is to make kind of a research hub where it is easy and transparent for people to find who is doing what. And that not only will help the researchers themselves, but will help young trainees or maybe even medical students to dresses for observerships or whatever opportunity they would like to have. So this is an idea we have and we would very much like to perceive.
Well, this is amazing. I think everybody will be elated to know that there is a place where to go to understand who's doing what and where to find answers from those who are already working on things. Another of the questions regards models in TBI translated to humans. So, but is Professor Rosami already answered that? So regarding blast injury and the translational research on that might be applied for military environment. Something else came up in terms of therapeutic targets. Where is the TBI research heading towards? So I will leave that to you for answering.
I don't know. I can probably start. Yes, but always we you know, I think all of us have started, did a lot of work on neuroprotection. You should get early with the drug and that will help benefit TBI patient. It's not that, but it seemed to be very difficult. I would think that targets, drugs that target the more chronic problems and the more evolving problems. And I think like anti-inflammatory drugs seem to be very promising in many aspects. So, and there are also drugs that target the mitochondrial function and the energy metabolism, et cetera. And then of course, refiner critical care for the severely injured as well. But I would argue for the more long-term chronic problems that arise after TBI, that can be good targets.
Another thing in my opinion is that all the treatments that are typically assessed that aim to, you know, to target one specific pathway goal, they tend to underestimate the complexity and heterogeneity of TBI in a clinical setting. So I guess what a lot of labs are doing to synergistically add and combine treatment approaches is probably a good way to go. Also, you know, treatments like stem cells that have just shown to be highly complex and difficult to translate, where a lot of effort has been put into, there are benefits of the stem cell transplantation that can be, you know, used in a cell-free kind of setting as well. And there are ways now to reprogram cells in the human body without, you know, the need to transplant cells. And In my opinion, if you have, if we have spent a lot of time on one potential treatment target like cell therapy, and we realize that it's potentially not as fruitful as expected, we should also be able to leave it, to take the beneficial aspects, and to move to the next, to the next treatment area, and to combine what we have learned with other treatment treatments that we have tested and where we have gathered some useful information, to combine this and to come up with, you know, a battery of different neuroprotective, neuroregenerative, functional, and also easily translatable treatment combinations somehow. Because I feel that translation is really, with those I would say simple treatment approaches, is really difficult. Also, I think the question was, or should we just skip the encephalic models? I guess not, because what the Brain Trauma Foundation, Operation Brain Trauma in the United States, and probably the ENO will maybe do as well, is to systematically and standard, with a standardized setting, go from standardized rodent models to larger animal models, and then a standardized version to clinical translation, which is probably way more fruitful than just, you know, rodents, go to the clinic, we do it differently, you do it differently. It's a mess. So.
Just to finish off, if I may, so I think there are multiple targets still to target. And as Niklas and Alexander explained, in therapeutics and drug development and how to investigate to improve the translational aspect, as Alexander just said, but there's more to that. And so the most of the improvement in outcome and survival has come from improved intensive care and monitoring and understanding and recognizing insults and reacting to that. And even there's a huge number of things to start better understanding. We have the monitoring tools, they yield data, and we know the numbers and the ICP, etc. But how to integrate that in pathophysiological events, there's still so many things that we're lacking there. So what we wanted to quickly validate PRX and start working on that in our lab, and we found that the Lassen curve is rubbish. It's not rubbish, but it's too simplistic. So in all aspects, there are still many, many things to target. And therefore, we need neurosurgeons interested in research. And thanks, Laura, for organizing this, because it's an important point, I think.
Yeah, I'm glad that we managed to pull this through with the help of the NF office, because I think that the participants being quite a lot, like, it's the sign that I'm not the only one interested and wanted to know more about how to start and what to target and how to formulate a research project. I'm thankful for you being here, taking time from your duties. And there is another question just about brain tissue from surgeries. Do you use human brain tissue from during neurotrauma surgeries? Small, tiny samples in research? No?
I have done it. There was the brain tissue bank, but that was, you know, contusion ectomies, basically, where we had to remove big contusion, not the routine small sample. We actually, I should mention that we were the first to take at the exact location of an EVD in trauma. We took small biopsies in the spot where we put the EVT in and did proteomics on that. You have to see that from a normal tissue, here right frontal lobe was totally different in the diffuse axonal injury patient than it was in more focal TBI patient. Okay. Again, stating that the molecular response to TBI is totally different between the different subtypes. So it's doable, but it's a lot of ethical issues and extreme safety concerns and all this aspect, of course, but it's doable. And in a sense, it is relevant. You need to do the rodent models comparisons also in human to the extent possible. But it's not easy. It's not easy.
So to all those who are still here, you see that translational is possible, even if they tell you we're a surgeon and we shouldn't bother and just focus on DOR and that's it. For some, it might work. For others, maybe not. It's not just you are. We have to look beyond that. There is a vast universe of things you can research about neurotrauma, neurosurgery, of course, but neurotrauma in this case. So I'm glad we were able here to talk about it for a while and watch our space, because I hope to be able to post on social medias and maybe even on the website from on the social media of the section, a map with all the labs of the section, so that you can reach out to the labs and you can bother them directly so that you can visit. And thank you everybody for being here. I don't know, there are no more questions, but I'm happy that there are a lot of participants from everywhere in the world. I'm seeing nice representation. There is a question actually. There is, are there opportunities to work with tissue from autopsies, like to collect tissue prospectively? So I think Professor Marklund was talking about this as well, maybe with the brain bank.
Autopsies, it depends. There's also, there's pros and cons to everything, but patients who die immediately, you don't get the development of pathology. Those who die a little bit later, if that's possible to do the analysis, yes, that would be, that's extremely helpful. There are some studies, Doug Smith in the US, for instance, has done important findings there on tau and beta amyloid. And yes, absolutely, that's possible. But then some have very long survival time points, and then maybe they are old and they get other issues just by aging. But yes, you should complement autopsies with fresh tissue if possible, and now refined MRI and the tau PET and everything else that you can do with imaging. So this combined can be a perfect complement to the rodent studies and comparing them translationally.
Thank you, Professor. So I think we can wrap it up. Thanks, everybody, really. It was a pleasure being here and having you explaining to us. Hope to see you soon again.
Thanks, Laura.
Thanks. Bye. To the next.
Thank you, Laura.